Good evening, everybody. This is Dave Wrigley with Playing the Gray. And again, part of our seven-part series with Ruth Nicholson, where she's got her 77 deadly challenges of sports organizations. And we've been counting them down. And with us again is Sam Snow. And Sam and Ruth are going to be talking about the issue of you've got to recruit and train new volunteers because of all that turnover. And we don't mean turnover because they found a better paying volunteer job somewhere else. It's because their kids age out. That's what sports is all about. There's another phase, another level to move on to. So Ruth, why don't you set the stage with this one about how did this hit the list at number five?
It hit the list partly because of the turnover aspect, whether it's kids aging out or choosing a different sport, or even going to the rival club down the street. And every year I've got lots of clients who have to train people over and over, and folks get tired of it. That it's like, they'll say, you know, didn't we just say this? Didn't we just have this meeting? And it's like, well, you get this meeting every year. And it's exhausting, particularly for staff. I think the thing that folks shortchange is the upfront work. So I have a formula for volunteers. It's 3-1-1, and it's three parts planning, deciding what kinds of volunteers you need, describing what those roles, what those jobs are, and making sure that you're training your volunteers for whatever it is you've asked them to do. So if they're volunteer coaches, helping them with coaching skills, Even people who you say, well, you volunteer to help me pick up trash at our tournament. There are certain things those folks need to know, like, eh, where are the trash bags? Where are the trash cans? Are we sorting trash from recyclables? So even very modest volunteer jobs have a training component. But we tend to blitz through all of that and just say, hey, will you show up on Saturday at 2 o'clock? And it's very nebulous. And it makes it harder to keep volunteers and retain them when you don't do that upfront planning. So the three parts is the planning and the recruitment and the training. The one part is actually doing the work. Thanking them, being very appreciative of what they're bringing, because that has real value to your organization.
And you cut out just a little bit there, Ruth, but I think we got all of which is basically the 3-1-1. Sam, anything you want to add to that before we, because I've got a few things I want to ask of each of you, but anything in general you want to add about how to bring people in and recognize that there's just inherent turnover, even on your best days?
Yeah, I think a club has to plan on churn, and that looking at it from the coach's side or that particular set of volunteers, does a club have a clear plan as to how they're going to help those volunteer coaches? And I think a similar plan would work for volunteer team administrators, team managers, whatever title is given to them, tournament, field marshals, et cetera, et cetera.
Now, so what I want to ask is, because you broke it down kind of where I was heading, which is there's volunteers, like there's game day volunteers, there's team volunteers, there's organization volunteers. The team volunteers, you know, they follow the kid. I mean, for sure. You know, that's a close parent-player relationship. What about organization? Because that is the one that usually scares people. And unfortunately, that turnover can really hurt because there's usually a transition involved. It's not something that you can, even your best planning, as Ruth said, you can say, this is the job on game day. This is what you do. This is how you do it. But at the administrative level, any thoughts on how to, again, you can't stop the turnover. You know, eventually people run out of kids that they're going through system. Anything that you found that really helps with attracting people to come into it, and also then being able to roll off, which I found to be an attractive thing, saying you're going to be allowed to roll off. You can come in and you're not trapped forever because we've got a system for letting you roll off and somebody else come in.
I've got a couple of ideas. One of them comes, the literature on volunteers dating back to the 70s. I can remember my mother telling me this, that if you're crafting a volunteer job and it requires more than an average of 10 hours a week, you're going to burn out your volunteers and they're going to leave. Now, that doesn't mean like you don't have an insane couple of weeks when you're handing out uniforms. But on average, if you're talking about 10 hours a week of volunteer time or more, you're in the red zone for that volunteer job. So I'm a huge proponent of actually sitting down and writing job descriptions. That's upfront work, but you don't have to do it every year for every job. And you talk about what are the skills you're looking for, what are the tasks, and how long do you really think those tasks are going to take? And really being honest with yourself about how big is this job, what supplies are needed to do that job, and who's going to provide them? Are you expecting the volunteer to provide them, or does the club provide them? And lastly, who do they work with? Who do they communicate with? What is that network that they need? And the thought process of going through that does a couple of things. One, it means when you're asking people to volunteer, you're really clear. You're not saying, would you show up on Saturday and help me with my tournament? You're saying, would you help me for 2 hours on Saturday morning check in teams? That's a lot easier to say yes to. You know what it is. It's time limited. I can give you 2 hours. That's easy. The other thing it does is it documents what that work is. So when you do have turnover, you're not scrambling. I had a client in Texas that called and said, Ruth, we're in trouble. So, well, what happened? Well, our registrar has been here for 15 years and she's finally decided she wants to retire. I said, well, okay. And what's the problem? Well, we don't have a job description for her. We don't know what she does. And I said, and she's leaving. So she's not actually motivated to write a job description, right? She's retiring. I said, well, first of all, take her out to a really nice dinner somewhere and thank her. And then you need to ask her some questions because you're going to have to come up with the job description and get her to talk about all the things that she does. And I worked with them to help them get that list of questions so they could write a job description so they could fill this job because they were absolutely panicked at losing their registrar and not knowing what she did.
Sam, I'm going to ask you to, and I think, Ruth, that's every time I think about how many times I've started to write a job description for somebody in an organization and then didn't, and it bit me every time. So I think people want to just trust me that what Ruth says is you're going to think it's easy and then you'll stop and you're going to regret it because you really do need to have that description, even if it's not perfect. But I want to dive into the technical part with you, Sam, because, you know, you want people to come in and, you know, be on the sideline, coach a kid up, you know, while you're talking to the field, or keep an eye on the field when you're talking to a kid. And we've talked about this in many episodes. There's that trust of who can you bring in to have that volunteer, because no one likes to be either ignored, just standing there without a voice as a volunteer, you know, trying to help the kids out. But at the same time, they need to respect you, the head coach, as to what you think should the emphasis should be, and to some degree how you want it delivered, whether it's, you know, with a positive spin to it. But can you get into how to draw in volunteers to help the team, not for setup, but for actual coaching on the field? And I know different leagues with different sports have different requirements. So we're going to kind of put that to the side here as to what makes you qualified to be able to stand on the sideline. But can you talk about allowing a system where you can attract people but let them even roll off, even if it's year to year as an assistant, maybe?
Dave, it's a constant challenge for clubs of all sizes all across the country are to be able to find coaches, whether that be paid, part-time, or volunteer. All of them are in the same boat in terms of having a struggle to be able to find people. And to be able to find people to volunteer to coach is probably the hardest one of all. The first issue for a club, thinking back to one of our earlier episodes, is for the club to take that time to do some strategic thinking about the coaching roles within their club and how do we go about trying to find coaches, what are we going to ask of the coaches. So as was just mentioned a moment ago, what's the job description of the head coach? If a team is lucky enough to have an assistant coach, which frankly is somewhat of a rarity, because of the lack of volunteers, what's the role of the assistant coach? I think part of what clubs need to do when they start to think strategically about that is, one, not hope that coaches just fall out of the sky and just show up at your club, or that they can go into the backyard and pluck one off of the coach tree. They have to have a real plan as to how are we going to go about actually finding where we might be able to get volunteer coaches. Don't confine yourself to just the parents of the current players in the club. That's a great place to look, but I would also look at local colleges, local schools, some of which you're going to have to be a little bit aware of. Well, this person is technically a minor, so I need to put it in an adult with them, a legal adult with them, just for the legal risk factors involved. But you know, just because somebody is a freshman or a sophomore in college and is a physical education major and actually has a keen interest in sports and learning how to coach, learning how to teach, that might be a great resource if you have that in a community college or a four-year school or what have you in your community. So my whole point being, have a plan, think beyond the pool of parents who are in the club, as to where we might begin to find some volunteer coaches. And then I think it's crucially important to not only have that job description, but also to be able to give that person who does volunteer, to give them some help straight away. Where can they go to find information and resources? Don't make them hunt for it. Give it to them. Point them directly to where it is on your website, on your league or state association website, the website of United Soccer Coaches, U.S. Soccer, et cetera, to be able to find the information to help you along as a coach. Because I've seen way too many coaches get asked to coach. They say yes. They're given a pile of jerseys. They're given a roster. Hopefully, they're given a schedule. And then it's good luck. See at the end of the season, sort of a deal. And they're left to their own devices to perhaps figure out how to coach. Even if the person has a soccer playing background, playing is very different than coaching. And so they're going to need some guidance, some assistance on how to coach. And the person who has no background in the sport, no background in coaching, is going to need some guidance as well. And there's a lot of good resources out there. Quite frankly, there's also a lot of resources that you'd be better off not taking a look at. It's just a waste of time. But how does the volunteer know that? They need some guidance from the club. So maybe we're circling back again to an earlier episode about the director of coaching, or at least someone on the board of directors who's going to take the responsibility of saying, I'm going to try to help give assistance and guidance to the coaches. It doesn't matter if you're an expert or not. You have, if your club is affiliated to the State Soccer Association, to U.S. Club Soccer, AYSO, whoever your club is affiliated to, contact those state-level, national-level organizations, and they will give you help. They will give you guidance as to how you can turn around and help the coaches in your club.
One of the things that I did when I was working at the club level every year was I had a who do I call list. And I really tried to make it fit on one sheet of paper, but it was for everybody in the club, coaches, volunteers, board members, and it had who was responsible for what. So if I had a uniform question, if I had a question about how to develop a session plan for team training, if I had to a field scheduling problem, whatever it was that one sheet that you would hand everybody and say, okay, when you need help, these are the people and here's how to get them. And you can easily add at the bottom those, you know, top 10 resources for session ideas or whatever, so that at the beginning of the year, you've got a little bit more than your roster and a stack of pennies.
Well, and I think that, you know, I'm going back to some things I've been brought into. And I had a woman who got me into coaching the first time, and I didn't want to be a part of it because it scared me 10, 12 years ago. I was worried about, you know, not doing well as a coach, not doing well as a dad while coaching my daughter and all that type of stuff. And she made it so, so simple, which was huge because I was hooked. I was in. I realized, okay, there's a way to do this that where you're just not going to be hung out to dry. And like you said, Ruth, she had provided us with contact numbers. She went laminated. She wrote things. She typed them up and she laminated them and she put a punch hole and she said, look, it'll go right on your bag. I mean, she just thought right ahead to what are all the ways that we're going to, you know, just be too baffled and confused someday and lose that resource. So I think this is a good place to end this one right there, which is, you know, look at all these other episodes, as Sam was saying, that, you know, somewhere within all these challenges is a solution to that is helping another, which, you know, it's just a sport. You know, we're all just grinning here, laughing at how it's just playtime, but this can get to be so complicated that it can really just, the organization can be the biggest opponent you've got, you know, in trying to get these kids on the field. So any closing words you want to add to that, Ruth?
Oh, I just wanted to thank Sam Snow for joining us today and helping us with his insights as well.
Absolutely. And again, that's two of the 7 episodes are with Sam. He's a huge resource to bring into it. And again, check out the bios, check out on the show description, you'll find a way to contact them, because again, Ruth here, aside from having put together a really good organization or a system for staying organized and really governing your group, she's brought in the experts here to have us talk it through, which I think Ruth is just invaluable. So thank you again.
Thank you, Dave.
All right. So thanks again for listening, everybody. Check out the other 6 episodes. And this is Dave Briglio and Friends with Playing the Great. Thank you.
They don't stop coming. Back to the rules, and I'll hit the ground running. Didn't make sense not to live for.